Please welcome Senior Vice President Marketing at BP and Chief Marketing Officer at Castrol, Nicola Buck, and Global Operations Director at BP Lubricants, Soren Malika.
Hi, everybody. I'm used to speaking about Castrol and the brand and how we market around the world. But it's the first time we've actually shared some of the work that we're doing in data. And so we couldn't be more excited to share that with you. And it makes us really proud to think about the Castrol brand being associated with technology and digital as we move into the future. So I'm Nicola Buck. I'm the CMO of Castrol. And I'm delighted to be joined by my colleague, Soren.
Hi. I'm the Global Supply Chain Operations Director with Castrol.
Brilliant. All right. So a few facts about Castrol to start with. I don't know, you may all be familiar with Castrol as that kind of, you know, the 1 litre packs that you pick up on the supermarket shelves and put into your car. But it's so much more than that. The Castrol brand has always been at the leading edge of engine oil technology and innovation across the globe. And a few interesting stats there. We lubricated the first transatlantic flight in 1919. Together with Honda, we've won over 500 motorcycle world champions. The land speed record has been broken 21 times, and we've been at the heart of that every time. You'll find us on the moon today, or on Mars today, on the rover, working with NASA. And we still work with leading motorsport brands like Alpine F1 around the world as well. So, you know, we consistently rank as one of the top lubricants brands in the world. It's a brand that is loved and cherished and has a huge heritage with its loyal customers. We market our products in over 120 countries and collectively serve more than 550,000 customers with nearly 200 million end users around the world. So the point of sharing that is it is a big business, and what that means is we have a lot of data. So if you take all of those examples that I just spoke to, they are indicative of many more, where we serve customers with individual local solutions, and we are known for that, and that's what's helped us grow to be the successful brand we are today. And with that, when we step back now, comes a huge amount of data that we can use and want to optimize. And that's our opportunity and our challenge. And so with that kind of heritage as well, we want to be leading performance-driven company. And so finding ways to use our brand, use our technology, and use our data is key to transforming the Castrol brand into the future. Castrol is part of BP, which you may or may not know. And so we are also on a journey towards net zero. So we have a published ambition of becoming a net zero company by 2050 and reimagining energy for people and the planet during that process. With that comes a number of challenges. So how do we embrace the energy trilemma, ensuring energy supply, lower emissions, and cheaper energy for our consumers? How do we do that? We need strong partnerships, and that's why people like Palantir, we're so delighted to be partnering with them to go on this journey as they help us embrace these challenges that we've got. And data is so important, as I've already said, for Castrol, but also the wider company, that taking that challenge on is something we need great partners like Palantir for. We've worked together for 8 years now. We have some great experience. We're going to talk about Castrol today, but happy to take any questions afterwards about other examples of as well as how we've started to transform the business. So I said earlier, we have lots and lots of use cases for where the Castrol brand and products come to life and how we use them, from the moon and Mars to F1 to automotive events. It means we have a lot of complex problems now, because as we move forward, and I'm sure many of you have also been hit by challenges with the supply crises recently, because we have that personalized approach to the way we take products to market, we have perhaps been hit harder than many by some of the supply challenges. How do we keep supplying the customers that we have served with the products that we've sold them for many years when we are so limited with all the headwinds that we face? And being customer obsessed means we want to solve that. We are determined to solve that. And we need to be able to move quickly out of crisis mode into business continuity mode to make sure we continue to serve those customers and grow the business. And that was the problem statement that led us to kind of work with Palantir on how do you start to solve this problem. We have a huge history. We're really proud of it. We need to keep supplying these customers. But suddenly you are hit with a wall of problems that, again, many of you, I'm sure, have faced yourselves. And so how do you do that? And how do you take all of that data and do something with it? And that's the problem that Soren and his team picked up to address.
Thanks, Nicola. To a person in supply chain, it almost looks as though for the last 18 months, the world is out to prove that Murphy's Law works. If anything can go wrong, it will. Who would have thought that all it takes to block the Suez Canal is one ship? If you thought you knew your supplier, that was great. But your supplier could have a supplier who has a supplier who might be in trouble. So that comes and hits you. And then if you look at one port that is congested, it doesn't take long for that congestion to cascade into multiple ports around the world. And for all of us who have been facing this challenge, it's been an incredible journey, because when we look at from a Castrol perspective, it's not that we hadn't faced these outages before, but they usually came as ones or twos. But when they start coming in a horde with lots of them, you really get stretched. And that becomes your challenge as to how do you manage this scale of disruption, which you have never really experienced. And many of these are once-in-a-lifetime events. So there is no real ready checklist to follow, say, these are the 10 steps, you do these and you're okay. So it's been incredibly challenging. And as Nicola said, with the kind of business that we run, it does mean a lot for us to be able to make sure that we are continuing to demonstrate the same standards of service and excellence that we do to our customers as always. So if I were to just kind of then talk a little bit about what the Castrol supply chain looks about. It's a global footprint. We have plants and manufacturing facilities all over the world. We have warehouses all over the world. There are interdependencies. As you would imagine, in a good global supply chain, it's not about having confined supply envelopes, but you have global supplies that go across the world. We do have multiple ways to reach customers. We could do a B2B, we could do a B2C, we could do a B2B2C, and there are different requirements each customer has. You've got to keep that in mind as you go along, because everybody doesn't see it the same way. As Nicola mentioned, our products and our product technologies are pride, and we formulate these products. These are formulated products on specific claims and guardrails. All of us are aware that if you're driving a car, it has to follow a certain emission standard. If you're in an industry, if you're using a lubricant for one of your machines, you would expect that machine to have trouble-free performance and be environment-friendly. So there are a lot of claims and guardrails that we've got to follow. So these are not products that you could just substitute one for the other. We do have OEM approvals. So we go through formal systems of approvals, especially around our B2B customers, and those approvals are sacrosanct. You know, we commit to a certain raw material, we commit to a certain plant or manufacturer, and that's what gives our customers the reassurance about the quality and resilience of our products. We often talk of make or buy. In Castrol, we do follow the make and buy, which is you make to buy better and you buy to make better. So, you know, when you're using this kind of a model, it also means you've got to kind of make your balancing decisions appropriately in view of what you're aiming to get. And as I said earlier, these are formulated products, so they are not just substitutable by something else that you have in the portfolio. These are very, very specific to customer needs. So given this, and given the nature of the challenge that we had, as Nicola mentioned, we had lots of data, so lots of data points to look at. The key thing was we needed an end-to-end solution. We could have looked at this in fragmented pieces and tried to optimize these, but it would never help, because we are really looking for something which is more globally optimized than just looking at something which was based in a particular market or a particular region. So with that in our mind, we set about working with Palantir on how we would solve this problem, and that's been an interesting journey. So we started working on an allocation problem. If you are in a global environment, you're in a global setup, what you want to do is you want to make sure that if there are shortages, you're able to allocate your products in the most optimal manner. You don't want one market to run dry while another carries inventory. You want to make sure that you're able to balance this appropriately, and especially when there are shortages, the value of this really, really shoots up. There are also customers with whom we have specific supply contracts, and those contracts are hugely strategic and very important. They're very specific. So again, they assume a certain importance as well. So when we started looking at, you know, solving this problem with Palantir, our first thought, actually, quite funnily enough, was to try and see if there's an out-of-box solution here, right? And conventional wisdom tells you it's probably the simplest thing to do. Find an out-of-box solution, fit it to your stuff, and turn the switch, and your car is running, right? Didn't work. And the reason for that was actually the fact that, you know, our data, you know, it came in various forms and from various sources. So to be able to fit it into a box was awfully difficult, which meant we had to change track. And we iterated very often during this project. We changed track and said, no, this is something we've got to create. And now let's start working on this with great velocity. So we changed a little bit of track from where we were at the start. In about 15 days, we were on a different track. And we said, OK, let's work this in a different way and look at what we need to do. So we set up this virtuous cycle that you see up there to kind of work through the various steps. And we had a broad framework in our mind, because it's not the first time we are dealing with a problem like this, just the scale, right? So we knew the logic. We knew what we wanted to do. So we started working with the Palantir team to configure this and figure out how this would best fit our needs. And as we kind of went along this journey to develop this tool, we looked at various options which would give us the right kind of result. And we actually finally landed on a certain configuration which had 6 apps, and I'll show them to you in a little while. Those 6 apps, they greatly helped us link up the end-to-end, which is where, you know, I started from. And it's been interesting to see how we did this, which I'll share with you. I think that the last thing I would share in regard to the solving the problem is this is an iterative process. You know, if we want to work in an agile manner, there are times when you go off into a direction, it doesn't work, you must have the agility to come back and do something else. And then, you know, figure that out and make sure you take that to a conclusion. And that's the approach we chose. So we worked very intensely between the Castrol teams and the Palantir teams, a huge amount of intense working to make sure that we were getting these things on the line. We also followed a very regular cadence of governance. So this was not about just, you know, letting the teams go off and do what they had to. It was also about ensuring that you had a regular cadence. And there were weekly meetings, there were quarterly reviews, and we also had a huge amount of focus on deliverables and making sure that they did. One of the things that helped during this governance process was what we called a front-loaded UAT. A UAT stands for user acceptance test. And we realized that if the tool had to be successful, we couldn't leave the testing for last. So we put in a huge amount of testing before we even showed the first version to a user. So as a team, we kind of subjected it to all kinds of testing and stress to see how it stood up. That allowed us a very clean rollout. When we actually went to the rollout, our rollout was actually fairly clean. So that's a step which I think, as part of our agile working, really, really helped us in terms of delivering the value. So what did we come up with? We actually came up with 6 apps. And we said, this is how it links up. You want an end-to-end view. So we started with what we called a supply chain 360. It basically shows you the end-to-end picture. Now, this is an interesting one because our data lay fragmented in various systems. So if you really had to understand the data end-to-end, you probably had to query a number of systems. What we did here is we got an end-to-end. So the data was available. We could see it end-to-end. We chose to make this our first module to roll out. We agreed on a modular process. So, you know, we did not choose the big bang of saying, let's go live with all 6. We chose them in a particular sequence. The first one we chose was actually the supply chain 360 because it gave us a really good end-to-end view. It also allowed us to move ahead with decision-making. So it may not have been completely guided by an outcome the tool gave, but it allowed us the visibility to make good decisions to maybe a P80 or P90 kind of level. The four apps in the middle are actually the apps that were used by our team that was managing the crisis. Right? So if you see those four apps in the middle, there's a virtuous iterative process that they run. Because you start off with the BST workflow, that is the business support team workflow. It goes on to understanding supply and demand as to how are those balancing out, what do we have, what do we not have, what are the kind of challenges. Then you look at the allocations. So if you have this, how would you allocate what you have? And then you look at potential mitigations. And those mitigations are business process mitigations. So we could go to technology, request a reformulation, or we could talk to a customer and phase inventory and so on and so forth. So using this, we kept getting back to the process of figuring out what was the best way to optimize our allocations, keeping in mind the importance of our customers, our commitments to them, and also ensuring that we were able to do this in an optimal manner. And the last app is the LT dashboard. For the CEO of Castrol, important for her to understand where we are on this, how is it working? So, it's important to have very clear visibility, which just says, look, this is the size of the gross problem. This is what the net is. This is the kind of impact that we have financially. Here are the list of actions we are doing. Pretty simple, right? So, but to reach that little simple stage, it's taken us quite a bit and a great amount of work to be able to do this. But I think overall, if I step back and now look at what we've achieved, I think it gives us really great end-to-end visibility now. And it also allows us to make decisions. We've been going live with these in a modular fashion. We went live with the Supply Chain 360 sometime in June. The remaining we actually have done over July and August. We just completed the UAT for the LT dashboard on Monday. And so we've actually completed this cycle where we've been able to make sure we implemented the modules, derived the value from them, then you moved on to the next one, completed that as well. So we're actually now in a fairly good place where our journey really is about now continuously improving. It would be wrong for Nicola and I to stand up and say, this is the best thing in the world. It is not. It definitely needs improvement. It definitely needs the team to keep on going at it and continuously improving. And one of the philosophies that I think as a team we regularly work on is, any digital tool is as good as its user. So you need good users to bring these tools to life, develop them, operationalize them, and take the value out of them. So our next step's really about what is the CI involved? How do we bring this into regular use, make it a very, very much a part of our working? But from the initial steps that we've seen, we had a couple of problems that we faced over the last couple of months. One, possibly many of us would have experienced, was the impact of the strikes in France, for example. But what would have taken us about 3 weeks to crack, we were able to crack in 48 hours. I think so that's really been the value of bringing this data together and being able to solve it. That still means you still need to react to everything that's happening in France. That's still, your team's got to do it. But I think that's really what it comes to. And as I kind of look back and introspect on, what we did on this journey and we will continue to do on this journey, I think that the key thing for me that stood out is the value of having a really good, committed team. Makes a huge difference, the kind of passion, the kind of capability you bring to bear. This is a picture of a team which is not one company. There are three companies sitting here, but I'm sure you can't say which company's badge they wear. They wore the badge for the solver. And I think that's really the importance of why a project like this can be a success, because you need to forget, your company badge, work for the success of the project. And this team really put a lot of energy, a lot of dedication, and a lot of commitment into making that work. And, it was amazing to see the kind of effort that went in, often late nights. We were really trying to crash our work schedules, making this happen in good time. There are times we fell behind the schedule. So we had to get back, figure out what we needed to do, how do we make this work. But I think in the end, if I were to really point out a big, big, big success enabler, I think we've got to give credit to this team that enabled this. With that, let me hand it back to Nicola.
And congratulations, Soren, on leading this work. If you can't see it on Soren's face, we're extremely proud of what we achieved together with the Palantir team on this piece of work. It helped us solve a really tricky problem that enabled us to continue delivering the level of customer centricity we believe in that underpins our brand. And ultimately, we managed to do it much quicker than a company the size of ours ever kind of thinks is possible. And that's exciting for the future. You can see there's key takeaways and learnings here, and I might just build and just say, you know, as I say, we've spoken today about what we call Castrol Solver, that's addressed the problem that Soren has talked to, but we have numerous other examples across the company. We did some work in our convenience business of bringing together all of our data streams to allow us to better manage working capital versus just-in-time supply of our convenience products. We did a great piece of work in our aviation business post-COVID to use the data to help us better allocate supplies as the COVID situation changed rapidly. And we worked with Palantir on addressing the fuel supply crisis in the UK that happened a little while ago as well, and helping us again better manage allocations accordingly. And in all of those, you know, the takeaways are very simple, that the combination of flexibility and velocity enables us to move ahead of the disruption and get back from crisis situation into business as usual really quickly. And that's important, especially in you know, difficult times where resources are limited. A disciplinary crisis room is important. Soren talked about bringing together teams, that notion of squads that are deployed to focus on a problem and solve it quickly is really powerful. Common operating picture, so bringing data together into one common picture that you can all work off. Don't ever underestimate the power of that. And ultimately, leveraging our data together with Foundry to build compounding value that really helps businesses move quickly through problems back to business as usual, and as I say, at pace. We often quote, you know, we're now operating out on cycles of kind of 6 to 8 weeks that would have taken us 6 to 8 months before. And that's a huge step forward for us and our brands. So thank you for listening.